Good morning, everybody. A warm welcome to all the participants who have arrived in Pune for this conference and have contributed largely to the success of this conference so far. Today's first topic, that is the maintenance treatment in metastatic urothelial carcinoma. Would like to share my screen for this topic. This is a sponsored symposium by Pfizer. This presentation flow would be the disease background and the landmark study which has been done for this drug, avelumab, javelin bladder 100, the design, efficacy, safety, tolerability, and the summarization, and a little bit information about the drug itself, Bevencio. We'll go through the slides one by one. Urothelial being the most common of the bladder cancers, more than 90%. And this is the 10th most common cancer worldwide. More than 5.5 lakh cases newly diagnosed globally in 2018 data and 2 lakh deaths globally in 2018. The survival has not been very good if we consider the local, regional or the distant metastasis cases. As we could see, the 5-year survival, it's for in situ, it's around 96%. For local disease, it's around 70%. For regional, it's just 35-36%. And for distant metastasis, 5-year is as low as 5.5%. And surprisingly, in the last 10 years, there has been not much improvement in the death rate from bladder cancers also. Approximately 5% of the patients have metastatic bladder cancer at diagnosis. 50% of the patients relapse after cystectomy. And 70 to 90% of the patients who relapse have distant mets. Traditionally, platinum-containing chemotherapy has been the standard of care for eligible patients for the last 20 years. It has its own limitations. We know that close to 80% of our patients would achieve a disease control with the ongoing treatment of platinum-based chemotherapy. But in spite of that, survival is poor with a median survival of 12 to 15 months. Wait and watch once we complete the chemotherapy may not be sufficient because 64% of the patients would progress within the 9 months and close to 25 to 50 or 55% of the patients are not eligible to receive any second line treatment because of probably toxicity issues or performance status related issues. Also, long-term use of chemotherapy may not be an option for advanced urothelial cancer patients due to toxicity. Concerns, comorbidities. Now looking at this drug trial, avelumab, it has not a first line platinum containing chemo. What was the study design of this javelin bladder? The key criteria of eligibility being unresectable, locally advanced or metastatic, at least one measurable lesion on RECIST. Patient must have received 4 to 6 cycles of platinum-containing chemotherapy, either gemcitabine cisplatin or gemcitabine carboplatin, and good performance status of 0-1. Key exclusion being patients with autoimmune disorders or medical conditions requiring systemic immunosuppression. The parameters which were studied were OS and PFS, and the patients with after the chemotherapy with CR, PR, or stable disease were taken up into this trial. The treatment was initiated 4 to 10 weeks after the chemotherapy got over. The randomization was 1:1, close to 700 patients, 350 in each arm with this drug, avelumab, 10 milligram per kg, intravenous infusion every 2 weeks, plus best supportive care compared to best supportive care alone. Treatment going on till disease progression or unacceptable toxicity. The primary endpoints, overall survival for all randomized patients, a subset with PD-L1 positive patients also. Selected secondary endpoint being PFS based on the BICR assessment. The stratification factors were best response to chemotherapy and site of metastasis, non-visceral, including the bony metastasis, assessed at the time of initiating the platinum-based chemotherapy. Tumor assessments were done at baseline at 8 weeks after randomization, then every 8 weeks up to 12 months. And after 12 months, it was every 12 weeks till documented progression based on BICR assessment. This drug also was permitted beyond a RECIST-defined disease progression if the patient was clinically stable or considered to be deriving clinical benefit as per the investigation. If we see the demographic baseline, both the arms were really well balanced. 75% of them were males in both arms. A substantial population, around 20%, was Asian, which was considered into the trial. According to geographic location, 60% were European and 20 to 21% were Asian in both the arms. Good performance status, ECOG 0 was seen in 61% of the patients, ECOG 1 in close to 39% of these patients. If we see the best response to first-line chemotherapy as one of the stratification criteria, the CR or PR was achieved in close to three-fourths, 72 to 70% patients in both the arms. A stable disease being observed in close to 28% of in both. Visceral metastasis, close to 50% of the patients, more than 50% of the patients had visceral metastasis on day one in both the arms. If you see the PD-L1 status, 54% in Bavencio arm and 49% in best supportive care arm. Status. Chemotherapy regimens were 1% reduction in the hazard ratio being 0.69. The OS was measured from time of randomization after the 4 cycles of platinum containing chemotherapy were done with. If you look at the subset of this drug demonstrating an OS in PD-L1 positive patients, as you could see again, the median OS was not reached in avelumab arm, and it was 17.1 months in the best supportive care arm. Here again, 44% reduction in the risk of the hazard ratio being even more significant here. And the PD-L1 status was, as we could, 39% negative, and in 10% it was a high landmark, what we see as milestones, timeline milestones. If we could see 12 months, in all randomized patients, 71 versus 58. In PD-L1 positive patients, 79 versus 60. At 18 months, again, for all randomized patients, 61% versus 44%. And 70% versus 48% in PD-L1 positive patients. If we do see the subgroup analysis and the forest plot, probably this Bavencio arm had a better outcome in all the predefined subgroups as far as the ethnicity was concerned. The type of chemotherapy regimen, the response to chemotherapy, visceral or non-visceral metastasis, creatinine clearance, and PD-L1 positive status. Of course, in the PD-L1 positive status, there is more favorable. It also demonstrated a meaningful improvement in delaying the disease progression. There was a 38% reduction in the risk of disease progression when for the patients who were put on Bavencio arm. The PFS at 12 months, 29% versus 13% for the best supportive care. At 15 months, 26.9% versus 11.9%. Best. There was patients who progressed in the best supportive care arm had an option there was a significant proportion of patients in the best supportive care arm who received sub-treatment with checkpoint inhibitor. Patients who progressed and discontinued because of roots and toxicities, 50% the intensive immunotherapeutic drugs, checkpoint inhibitors as the subsequent regarding the safety and tolerability of this drug, events that had found thyroidism, immune related reaction, maybe nausea, arthralgia, pyrexia. Infusion treatments are reported in personal patients. Ma'am. 0.9% experience grade 3 or infusion related. Fatal diseases and stroke were reported in 2 patient population treated with dimethylbam. Patients discontinued the drug because of adverse events. And the analysis of the quality was not negatively impacted with administration of the drug by as maintenance versus best supportive care alone as measured by the parameters. High dose of cortic prednisolone or equivalent were administered for an infusion-related AE in the 9% of the patients on this avelumab. hypothyroidism, rash, hyperthyroidism, pruritus, pneumonitis also were anomaly. Thyroidism, I think 10%, and the others maybe 1 to 2% of these for patients. Avelumab patients remained on treatment at least for 6 months. So patients exposed to this drug for more than 6 months were 47%. And patients exposed to this drug for more than 1 year were close to 28%. To summarize, the first line treatment maintenance with this avelumab plus best supportive care improved the overall survival versus the best supportive care alone in patients with locally advanced or metastatic malignancies. There were 11.1 in the Bavencio arm versus 14.3 in the best supportive care arm. 31% No audible.
So, can you hear us?
Yeah, am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you're audible, sir. So, just give me 2 minutes, sir. I'll just share the slides from my screen. Okay. Just give me a minute, sir.
I'm putting off my video anyways.
Yes, sir, your video is off.
So, video is off. So, I think if I'm audible, I'll continue now. Should I proceed?
So let me know when to start. So should I go to the next slide?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So you can tell me when to stop.
Yeah. So to summarize, first line maintenance with this therapy improved the overall survival as compared to best supportive care alone for patients with locally advanced or metastatic urothelial cancers. There was a 7.1 month improvement in the OS. 21.4 months versus 14.3 months as compared to best supportive care alone. There was a 31% reduction in the risk of death as compared to best supportive care alone arm. Survival of at 18 months was 61% in the Bevencio arm as compared to 44% in the best supportive care arm. The safety and tolerability of this drug was generally consistent with the prior experience with avelumab as a single agent. 12% of the patients discontinued the drug due to adverse events. Grade 3 or more treatment-related adverse events occurred in just 16.6% of the patients receiving Bevencio plus best supportive care. The quality of life was not adversely impacted during the administration of this drug as maintenance with best supportive care. So this drug, Bevencio, avelumab maintenance is recommended by ESMO guidelines committee in the metastatic urothelial cancers who have not progressed on platinum-based chemotherapy after 4 or 6 cycles. Next slide. Next slide. Regarding the mechanism of action, I think we need not go into the details of this. Bevencio binds to the PD-L1 on tumor cells, blocking the PD-L1, PD-1 interactions and activating and stimulating the anti-tumor immune responses. Next slide. So platinum-containing chemotherapy has a direct cytotoxic effect and which may help in controlling the tumor burden. And the lower the tumor burden, the higher the response rates for the immunotherapy. That's what has been observed. The chemotherapy may itself enhance the anti-tumor activity of the immune checkpoint inhibitors. Next slide. In patients, these previous studies with melanoma and NSCLCs, where it was a smaller tumor burden baseline, was associated with a good response and a duration of response to anti-PD-1 antibody treatment. Next slide. So chemotherapy may enhance the anti-tumor activity. Again, this was also seen in the durvalumab study in patients with advanced urothelial malignancies. This data suggests that effects of platinum-containing chemotherapy on tumor burden may actually enable increased anti-tumor activity with maintenance therapy involving a immune checkpoint inhibitors. Next slide. Maintenance therapy has the potential to maintain and extend the benefits of that achieved by platinum-containing chemotherapy in patients whose disease has not progressed. Chemotherapy has a range of immunogenic effects which may enhance the anti-tumor activity of these checkpoint inhibitors, including the induction of immunogenic tumor cell death, depletion of the immunosuppressive immune cells, increased CD8 plus T-cell infiltration, and increased presentation of tumor antigens. Maintenance therapy with Bevencio targets tumor cell populations persisting after chemotherapy before disease progression occurs. Next slide. Regarding the dosage and administration, this trial, Javelin used the dose of 10 milligram per kg every 2 weeks, but now there's a flat dosing regimen, 800 milligrams IV infusion, we're given over 60 minutes every 2 weeks. Pre-medication and adjustments to the infusion rate can help manage infusion-related reactions, which may occur in 10% of the patients. Pre-medicate with antihistamine and a paracetamol prior to the first 4 infusions of this drug. If the 4th infusion is completed without an infusion-related reaction, pre-medication for subsequent dosage should be administered at the discretion of the oncologist or the physician taking care of the patient. So 800 milligram flat dose, 60-minute infusion every 2 weeks, pre-medicate for the first 4 infusions. If there is no reaction in the first adverse infusion-related reaction, the first 4, probably without pre-medication also, we may be able to administer this drug. Next slide. So there are various dose modifications which have been mentioned for infusion-related reactions, pneumonitis and hepatitis. And these are the, depending on the severity, grade 1 to grade 2, we just allow them to settle. Grade 3 or grade 4, we may have to permanently discontinue the drug. Next slide. Next slide. Next. Next. Special warnings and precautions for this. I think infusion-related reactions, we have discussed that. Next slide. Immune-related adverse events, there is a guideline which mentions how to tackle these immune-related pneumonitis, hepatitis, colitis. Next slide. And hypophysitis also. Can we move on to the next one? Endocrinopathies, yes, thyroid disorders, quite common, and they can occur at any time during their treatment. Patients should be monitored for changes in thyroid function at the start, then periodically, and as indicated based on the management with replacement therapy and hyperthyroid with antithyroid medicine for any grade 3 or grade 4 thyroid disorders. Next slide. Next. So I think this drug, Bavencio, Avelumab, plus best supportive care, offers beyond chemotherapy if for the patients who have not progressed on chemotherapy in urothelial malignancies, and gives us a good 7-month OS benefit of 21 versus 14 months as compared to best supportive care alone, then given at the dosages mentioned as per in the prescribing guidelines. The infusion-related reactions associated with these drugs are manageable with proper pre-medications. There is no adverse effect on the quality of life with this medicine at 12 months and at 18 months, both as compared to best supportive care. There are more people who are living. The risk of progression or death is decreased. Also, if the PD-L1 status is positive, probably it has a better effect. But regardless of PD-L1 status, this drug could be given as a maintenance to the patients who are not progressed on a platinum-based chemotherapy in the metastatic urothelial carcinoma. Thank you for attending the program. If you have any questions, we can take it up.
Thank you so much, sir. If you have any questions from our audience or from the virtual audience as well,
I would just like to point out 2-3 things. I think similar trials have been done with other drugs also. So a phase 2 pembrolizumab also a similar trial where almost 108 patients were enrolled, and there is a survival benefit and a BFS benefit, which is seen as a maintenance therapy when given after the platinum-based chemotherapy is over. There is another drug whose data is also available in the same category of medicines, immune checkpoint inhibitors, where they are giving, trying to give this drug upfront along with chemotherapy, atezolizumab with chemotherapy versus only chemotherapy. And there's again good data regarding the PFS and the survival benefit. I think with all the available information, immune checkpoint inhibitors, regardless of the PD-L1 status in urothelial, high-grade urothelial malignancies, will serve as a good maintenance treatment after the completion of platinum-based chemotherapy.